I wonder if we can go to Luke chapter 24. I want to talk about our awareness of Jesus, our awareness of Jesus. There is a phrase that we will read in a moment that highlights, I think, itself above every other word in this passage, where two early followers of Jesus said, "Were not our hearts burning within us?" In the Message translation, it says, "Did we not feel on fire?" Feel on fire. And I don't know about you, you know, there are times when I am very aware of the presence of Jesus. And many other times when it is a matter of faith, of knowing that he really is there with me, because I don't feel anything. But I wonder, how aware are we of Jesus in our lives? Are you aware of him outside of the corporate gatherings? Are you aware of him in the all-consuming or the quiet moments? And I have to admit, I don't want my life just to be a matter of objective belief. And I think this alludes to some of what Sian was sharing too. I want it to be personally experienced too. And like she said, I think it's a both and, not one or the other. And if we are going to be people that reveal Jesus to the world, then we need to experience and be aware of him ourselves. We want people to come into our gatherings. We want people to meet with us in the street. We want people to talk with us even over the phone and be aware of Jesus in us and working through us. But you and I, if we are willing to be really honest, need to grow in our awareness of Jesus in our lives. So let's look at this passage. It's Luke 24, starting at verse 13. Now that same day, two of them, that's the same day that Jesus had risen from the dead, that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from being aware of him or recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" So, you know, this event of Jesus' death and then resurrection, this wasn't just a story that was known by a few in the city. This was citywide talk. "What things?" he asked. You can almost hear Jesus chuckling under his breath, can't you? "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." And as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. Jesus is really playing the part here, isn't he? "But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they became aware of him, and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, when are our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? Then they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. Just stop for a moment. Just consider that. Now, it says they went to Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. It says that they got up immediately and left to return to Jerusalem, 7 miles in the pitch dark. In the pitch dark. But they were so consumed because they had become aware that Jesus really was alive. They were compelled to return in the pitch dark, stumbling perhaps over the path along the way to tell the other followers of Jesus that he really was alive. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how they became aware that Jesus really was there when he broke the bread. And while they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Wow. Wow. So you and I, if we are going to grow in our awareness of Jesus, what can we do? Well, first of all, we can become more aware of his presence. So Jesus actually, he came along and started walking with them on the road before they were actually really aware of who he was. He'd already started walking with them before they fully became aware that he was Jesus. They were kept from recognizing him. There was a temporary blindness, if you like, on their eyes. But it was later on that they recognized and reflected back and said, "Of course, were our hearts not burning within us when we were talking with him on the road?" You know, there's an incredible comfort in knowing someone's presence, isn't there? One of the greatest blights in our society today is loneliness. But you and I have the privilege as followers of Jesus of knowing that the Spirit lives within us, that we are never alone. And I want to encourage you again today that, you know, if at any point, for whatever reason, you are struggling with loneliness, that again, you would start to declare out in truth, "God, I am not alone. You are with me. You are with me. God, would you make me aware of your presence?" David spoke these words in Psalm 139, "Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Nowhere. If I went up high, if I went down low, if I went to the ends of the earth, you'd still be there." You and I, we are not alone. But let's be honest. So often we are unaware, maybe temporarily, of his presence. And my only encouragement, I think, really to you today again is to continue seeking him. To continue seeking him, to have room to seek God in your life. We know the scripture well in Jeremiah 29, don't we, where it talks about God's plans for us being good, but it goes on to say later that you will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And so God wants to be sought. And I believe that you and I will become more aware of his presence when we seek him continually. Listen to these words from Bob Sorge, a well-known American worship leader and writer. "When you're in his presence for extended periods, the molecular composition of your soul gets restructured. You start to think differently, and you don't even know why. You start to have different passions and interests, and you don't even know why. God is changing you on the inside in ways you can't cognitively analyze. All you know is that sinful affections that once pulled at your soul no longer have their former power over you. The secret is simply this: large chunks of time in God's presence." There's no quick fix, right? But our growing awareness of who Jesus is in our lives will come when we deliberately, intentionally spend time, as Bob Sorge is suggesting here, large chunks of time in his presence. Let me talk for a few minutes about actually even being more physically aware of his presence. I wonder if we can go to the next slide. Look at this scripture here. Solid food is for the mature, who because of practice have their senses trained to discern good and evil. If you're looking at the NIV, it translates it as who by constant use have trained themselves. And so it misses the original literal translation, which talks there about an engagement of the senses. Now, that could be physical or spiritual, but there is a sense in which you and I become more aware of what is going on spiritually as we practice, as we make use of the senses. Surely there's been a time perhaps when someone has come to you and they believe they have a word from God for you, and they might say, I sense that God is saying. Because you see, in some way or another, they have engaged physical or spiritual senses to be aware of Jesus and what he is saying. It may be that physically your eyes are drawn to something, and it is God's way of making you aware of what he wants to say. Maybe you hear something, or you even smell something, or as we see from the story of Isaiah, it was a multi-sensory experience of God. And I believe there is a way in which God wants to capture and make use of the senses that he has given us to make us more aware of him. It is not that we wholly rely on them, but they must be there for God to use. He created us with them in the first place. That word senses, the original Greek word is aestheterion, which from which we get the word aesthetics. And the word aesthetics, of course, isn't it about, you know, sort of our principles of taste and art and beauty. And I wonder if perhaps, can I suggest this, and I think it's a safe place to do so, that creative people perhaps can be more perceptively aware, sensually aware, if you know what I mean, in the right sense, that with their senses they are aware of beauty and what is going on around them. Surely then God would want to use people who are sensually aware, who are perceptive through their senses, that God would use those things, what we see and what we hear and what we smell and what we touch, he would use these things to make us more aware of him. And I don't think it needs to be forced, but invite yourself to actually have permission to say, okay, God, that's interesting, the fact that my eyes are drawn to that thing on the wall. God, why is that? God, do you want to say something through what I'm seeing there? God, that's an unusual sound. My ears don't usually tune into that sound. God, are you wanting to say something? You know, in the same way that we could become aware, more aware of Jesus in our lives, we also perhaps sometimes in certain environments become aware of or sensing something not right about the presence of a place. You know, when you walk in and you just think, I don't like the feeling in here. You can't exactly put your finger on it, but again, you are, if you like, by virtue of ongoing practice, discerning something perhaps that is evil. And again, God can lead you and show you how to respond. So let's make every use of what God has given us, physically and spiritually. And so as we might see physically with our eyes, then in a spiritual sense, with spiritual sight, God can show us how to respond to him. You and I, we can become more aware of his presence. Sometimes I've talked with different people and I see the fact that I think God uses us all uniquely. And maybe there are certain ways in which you will be aware of God's presence that you even respond to or feel physically, but others wouldn't do. They might respond differently. And maybe you can learn to become aware of when that happens repeatedly. You know, if God is perhaps someone that always speaks to you through the sense of heat, for example, that you might learn to run with that. And, you know, this perhaps might feel like strange or odd territory to wander into, but if you're seeking to be in submission to the Holy Spirit and in submission to leaders around you, that can be a safe place to explore and say, God, help me to become more aware of the way that you would speak through me and work through me. Help me to become more aware of the way in which you would work through my physical and spiritual senses. So those two followers of Jesus, they were not immediately aware, were they? But actually at the point at which he then broke bread, it says their eyes were opened. And then they were able to look back and realize, you see, God was doing something in their hearts, but on the road, for whatever reason, they didn't recognize it. But I wonder if on future occasions, when they felt burning hearts, whether they would then learn to recognize that it really was God amongst them. They would know it for future. So number one, you and I, we want to be aware of his presence. Number two, we want to be aware of his guidance. What is so beautiful and painstaking here is that Jesus takes a considerable amount of time to talk with them on the road from the scriptures. Verse 27, that he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Jesus took time to open the word to his disciples. And you and I know this, but let me just say it again, because I think, if anything, I think my passion now more than ever with anyone that God gives me to train and disciple is to encourage them again and again to be fed by the word of God. Jack Deere writes in his book, Surprised by the Voice of God, why didn't Jesus simply reveal himself to the disciples? I think it's on the next screen. Why didn't Jesus simply reveal himself to the disciples at the beginning of their walk? Jack Deere is responding to this story that we've just read. Why did he take them to the scriptures? Jesus was telling us right at the very beginning of the church's history that the primary way he will be known is through the scriptures. This is the primary benefit of the Bible. It reveals Jesus to us. And as lead worshipers, worship leaders, team members, whatever you want to call yourselves, we have a responsibility to be deep in God's word. That out of the overflow of feeding on his word, we will encourage and inspire others to do the same. Let me ask you a very simple question. Have you got a good diet, a good spiritual diet? Do you have a Bible plan? Or is it random, open the cupboard and see what's for breakfast? We were talking at breakfast this morning, the worship team, about what our favorite kind of breakfast was. Some people don't eat breakfast. Some people pile on the plate. But what is your spiritual diet when it comes to reading the Word of God? Have you got something that you are doing to regularly feed, and it's a broad, healthy diet of God's Word? And that is where you and I will know his guidance. How many times have we read his word and you know it's hitting a spot right away? You're like, God, that's exactly what I needed to hear today. I always encourage people that when they're reading God's word to read with their antennae up. Beep, 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 beep. You're ready and looking to, if you like, connect with the station. God, what's your word for me today? Because, of course, every bit of it is a wonderful, rich diet, every bit of God's word that we can take in. But there's going to be one part, I believe, that God wants to just get a hold of us and say, that's for you to really chew on. Don't just swallow that. Chew it and chew it and chew it and chew it and let all the goodness come out of your mouth. Chew it, chew it, chew it. And then you will fully be able to absorb it. When we don't chew properly, we don't absorb the goodness in the food as well, do we? But actually, when you chew it over and over, then it breaks it down for us, and our body is able to absorb the goodness. So being aware of his guidance means digging deep into his word. And I know this is not fresh and new, but that's my encouragement to you again, if anything else from today. Get deep into God's word. And then alongside his word, with the gift of his Holy Spirit, we know that the Holy Spirit guides us. That's his name. When he, the Spirit of truth, comes, Jesus said, he will guide you into all truth. And so that guiding voice of the Spirit, wonderfully leading us, showing us where to go, revealing the way ahead. So be aware of his guidance. And then finally, number three, being aware of his divinity. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us? Interesting, isn't it? Just as we were talking about the senses, that they said there that their eyes were opened. They had revelation of who Jesus really was. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us? What will the enemy want to do in our lives? He will want to take our eyes off Jesus. And if we are going to grow in our awareness of Jesus, we have to keep our eyes on him. Whatever that takes, whatever that means in terms of dealing with distractions or dealing with idols in our lives. I don't know if it was said by someone or if it's just a popular saying, but you will become like what you behold. You will become like what you behold. And as you and I take time to keep gazing on who Jesus is, becoming more aware of who he is, then we will become more like him. See, whatever the world has to offer, the entertainment or the distractions of this world, they tend to dull our senses, don't they? Because whatever they are, they're lewd or they're coarse or they're impure. They cause us to lose sensitivity. But actually fixing our eyes on Jesus means that we will actually grow in a discerning and a sensitivity that moves us at the smallest. I want to be somebody who is easily moved by God. I saw a movie earlier this week called Lion. Anyone seen it? Whew. I was a wreck, an absolute wreck. And I'm a bit of an emotional guy anyway, but honestly, I was just in streams. But I realized that, you know, if a movie which plays on your heartstrings because of, you know, the pain of somebody's life, if that can move me, how much more do I want to be moved by Jesus? So becoming aware of his divinity means that we fix our eyes on him. You know that scripture, Hebrews 12, fix your eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Let me ask you, are your eyes fixed on Jesus? Or are they distracted by other things? So let's just pause for a moment. Let's just review again what I've been saying, and I trust more than what I've been saying, what God has been highlighting to you. Are you growing in your awareness of Jesus? Are you seeking him? Are you pressing in to seek him continually? Are you willing to allow him to work through your senses, both physically and spiritually, to become more aware of what he is doing, and in turn, to see what the enemy is doing, and in response, come back in the power of the Spirit? Are you aware of his guidance? Are you pressing into his word? Are you somebody that is saying, God, I will spend time with you, and I will dig deep into your word, and I will rely on the guiding voice of your Holy Spirit? And are you more and more aware of his divinity, his place as God over your life? Are you fixing your eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of your faith? So I wonder if, in response, we're going to go into another time of sung worship before we come to lunch. And I would love if, in this time, if our musicians want to come back, I wonder if, in this time, whether you would deliberately come with me and not be wholly focused on lyrics or wholly focused on music and harmonies and whatever else you're prone to do as a musician or a technician or an artist or a creative, but instead focus on becoming aware of Jesus. You see, we can be assured of his presence, can't we? That right now he's here with us by his Spirit. And he is God, so he can choose right now to do something very intense and tangible, or he may not, because he's God. But however he chooses to show himself, then we want to grow in our awareness. I'm going to pray just in a moment, but I wonder if, just as your response to God, whether you would like to find a position, a physical position, or a space in the room where you feel you can most easily engage with the Lord. If it's just sitting where you are, that's fine. But if you would like to move to another space, or you would like to kneel or lie down or stand, that's entirely up to you. But let it be a physical position that allows you to respond to the Lord. You know, as charismatics and Pentecostals and Spirit-filled believers, we love this word encounter. But I'm not sure that the church always understands what that really means. What I do know and believe is that I want to meet with God. So, Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to be here on the earth. And just as those two believers on the road to Emmaus encountered you, even though they didn't fully recognize it at first, I pray that now in this time that we have, we would become more aware of your presence. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to do a work of comfort. And to do a work of warming the places that have felt cold and dry. And I pray that there would be a re-sensitizing of our senses that would open our hearts to you. That physically and spiritually we would become so much more aware of you. And the result would be hearts more deeply in love with Jesus. Because we want to be with the one that we love. We want to be with the one that we love. And we don't want our time with Jesus to simply be imagined or a matter of objective faith. But we want it to be felt. We want it to be known deep in our hearts as well as our minds. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. To you. Open up my ears to you. Let me see you. Let me hear you. Jesus. Open up my eyes to you. Open up my ears to you. Let me see you. Let me hear you. Just as the band begin to sing and play now, then allow them to minister to the Lord. But you let this be a moment to become more aware of his presence and his guidance and his divinity.